Bibles to the book of Ezekiel, and it's chapter 4 and 5 that we're going to do to eventually look at. It takes about 6.5 minutes to read chapter 4 and chapter 5, and I'm going to endeavor to do that for this time. But it's always good before you launch into a book as big as Ezekiel, which I think is 48 chapters long. It's always good just to talk about the book a little bit and kind of get us reacquainted with this amazing prophetic writing that is from up to 2,500 years ago, so it's fairly ancient time of Israel. And we are continuing on looking at class four, four signs of coming judgment. And of course, we know we live in a day and age in which any reference to judgment or to hell or to God's condemning sin, anything like that is usually not allowed in our current culture today. Our popular culture today likes to just pretend that there's no such thing as death, there's no such thing as accountability to the holy God that is above us, or anything like that. So when you enter this concept of judgment, somebody might be saying, you know, how do you even do ministry with that J word staring at you? It seems so perplexing. It seems so hard just to get through this thing. Can we just kind of rush through this? Can we just kind of just, you know, somehow just maybe make this a bite-sized message and make it shorter and sweeter and nicer, put a lot of padding on it so that we can get through to the nicer side, the upside, which is talking about restoration, the kingdom to come, and all those good things that are on the tail end of the book of Ezekiel. Well, in fact, the Lord would have us actually to slow down and to really consider these things that are a bit difficult. And you're going to find out from this, the reading of Ezekiel 4 and 5, this is one of the most severest readings of the Word of God entirely. And I need to set the context for you as to what was going on 2,500 years ago in the land of Israel, in the land of Judah, when this four signs of judgment comes down through the prophet of Ezekiel, who is formerly a priest of the temple. Now the temple is going to be vacant. The glory of the Lord is going to be lifted up and gone away from the temple. And now Ezekiel is left not as a priest, but as a prophet to warn the nation of the coming judgment of God. Now as I say that to you, the coming judgment of God, there should be a rejoinder or somebody, a comeback, where somebody says, hello, excuse me, why is God judging? That's always a good question to ask. Why is God judging? What would cause him to do that? Is this some kind of God that just wakes up in the morning and says, you know what, I'm bored. Is there anything that I can blow up? You know, I love to blow up things. Is there anything that I can blow up today? No, God is not a God who loves to destroy or anything, especially his own creation. So it's perplexing, even the word judgment. Why would the God of love, the God of peace, the God of all understanding and patience judge at all? And it's good for us to revisit the whole story on Israel, in particular the story of Judah at this time, as to the answering the question, why would God even judge to begin with? This is a severe passage, and it's almost on the level of the time of Noah. How many of you are familiar with Noah's Ark and the time of Noah? I mean, if you really look at that, you start to understand that it is massive. The massive annihilation of human life, except for a family of eight that are preserved in a boat, in a structure, in a wood structure. And the rest are floating bodies floating to the top of the water because their lungs are full of salt water and they've been basically smote. They've been killed by the Almighty. You know, you just walk into that and, you know, you don't know the story behind that. You go, wait a second, hold on. I don't understand that. This is very perplexing. This is just outside of my realm. Of course, we know, if you know the story of Noah, going back to Genesis chapters 6 and 7 and 8 and 9, you know the story of Noah was that before God put all that water upon the earth and flushed basically human life almost totally out of existence, that before that time, what was the cities around Noah known for? What were they known for?
Sin.
Sin. There's a particular sin that starts with the letter V. Violence. violence upon the land. So it was just a wrong treatment of human life. Now, we don't know how they did this, if it was like the Roman Colosseum where they sported, you know, in front of everyone, the sporting the killing of other human beings, or how they did it exactly, but they were known for bloodshed. They were known for violence. And it wasn't just for a small amount of time. It was for a big, long amount of time. Noah himself lived for a very long time, and so he saw this all in front of him. And then came the time, the moment in which Noah said, okay, the doors are literally closing, and now is the time for judgment. Now the time when the earth, the bottom of the earth comes up with water, and the floods come down, and then, of course, all mayhem breaks loose. But, of course, it's not mayhem. It's the severe judging hand of God across the land that is occurring. That is somewhat descriptive of what you see here with regards to Judah. That is somewhat descriptive of what you're seeing here 2,500 years ago with regards to Jerusalem. Jerusalem was a nation that was raised up to be a nation that was sort of like the capital of all the other nations around to showcase the holiness of God to other nations. So other nations would look upstream. They would look up to Israel as the standard, the high premium of holiness. That's who you want to look to. And of course, we know the story of Israel. If you can imagine them being, they're not literally like this, but to be on a high mountain, you know, say Mount Hiroshima or something like that, and you have a high city on a high hill, and they're the beacon city for the whole earth to look to. These people of God, they are the holy people. You want to follow their God. You want to walk in step with them. And the narrative and the story of Israel was as if you were to take that high hill and you were to invert it and turn it into a steep valley of total idolatry, total a mishandling of human lives, total wretched sin. So it went from a mountaintop to a valley because of the sin of the people. Now, how does God take that? Does he say, well, you goofed? Well, you were supposed to be a nation that all the other nations would look to, but you goofed, you dropped the ball, but, you know, no harm, no foul. No, God does not say that. God judges in the face of this outward rebellion of the people. And it had to do with idolatry. Most of it had to do with the people of Israel turning their face from God and going their own way of pagan idolatry. And that even involved, as we know, the story of Molech, the god that they worshipped. His name was Molech. And he was a god of fire or something like that, where they would actually give their children to Molech and burn their children alive so that whatever would come down, they would get a better crop or they would get some kind of fringe benefit from that child sacrifice. That's horrific. That's absolutely gross. And so God is bringing down judgment on Judah, specifically on Jerusalem, because of the ongoing, centuries-long disobedience that they were part of. And as we get closer into the book of Ezekiel, and we look at chapter 4 and chapter 5, to help you along here with regards to this passage, it's going to give you four signs of God's coming judgment, but I would like you to see these in a sort of as one sign altogether. I know I'm using the number four, but think of it as one broad sign. And the good way to help you through this passage as I read through it is to think of, we used to have curtains up here. We don't have them now. But if you can imagine behind me, maybe a large panorama view of Jerusalem. It's about to be smote with fire and all that. From one side to the other side, you're going to see like the siege of Jerusalem as the Babylonian army comes in. And if you can imagine in the center point, maybe like a curtain, and it is closed at first. And it's gradually being opened for you in front of your eyes, and your eyes get wider and wider and wider as you see what's in the mural. And it's the whole, basically, downflow of God's wrath through the means of the Babylonian siege, which is where they cut off all the supplies of Jerusalem so that the people on the inside were starved to death. And you're starting to see those panels or that drape open wide gradually, and you're seeing more of the signs. The four signs are becoming more and more clear as you see the panoramic view of this. This is rather stark, and you're going to see this how this unfolds. Ezekiel is the man who's going to be doing one of the most ghastly, horrific versions of charades that you could ever imagine. I don't know if you know the game of charades. It's where And we play it with Awana from time to time. You know, I pretend I'm something, and I don't say anything maybe, but I do some kind of motion, and they go, aha, I know what you're doing, Mr. Szabo. You're being like a car, or you're being like a bicycle, or you have some object that is associated with your motion so that they know what you're talking about, so that they can guess what you're doing. And this is sort of like a ghostly version of charades, where Ezekiel, in a very bizarre way, is going to be giving four signs, sometimes with verbal action, actual prophesying, but many a times it's just going to be something that he does in front of people as they do this. That's weird. What is that? Did you see that? That is weird. What happened? This guy used to be the priest in our temple. Now he's doing this weird stuff on that hill over there on that mound. What is up with that? It would really cause people to stir, maybe pause, say, that's so bizarre, I've never seen anything like that. Are you sure that you're in your right mind even? Perhaps you're insane. That's the kind of things that probably the people were thinking as they saw what Ezekiel was doing in this open display, a display of the coming judgment of the land of Jerusalem, of the land of Judah. I'm going to back up before I launch into chapter 4 and 5 and give you some help with regards to ministry, evangelism, and ministry. And it's always good to do this before you launch into something hard and not easy, like the judgment of God, especially for his own people, that you back up a little bit and say, you know, I would like to know, how is this going to help me with regards to ministry, with regards to evangelism, with regards to being salt and light to the nations around me? Or is this just going to drag me into a sort of a dark hole where I'm really depressed because things are so pitifully bad? How do you see any light in all of this? And the thing that I would advise to you is that we don't ever want to be caught into a vortex pull of what I call fatalism. Fatalism is where you say, well, then it's all for naught. The gospel, the Great Commission, it's all for naught. Everybody's against us. So just turn over the apple cart and we're done. Fatalism. That can easily creep in to people's minds so they get distracted from why they're on this earth, is to proclaim Christ, is to go uphill, to go up a hill against gravity and still proclaim the glories of our salvation. So we don't want to fall into fatalism. And there's something here, actually in chapter 5, verse 3, that I'll highlight that actually will help us that. Another thing that, and this may not sound impressive to you that much, but I think that most people, when they're thinking about going into ministry, it says somewhere in the Bible, as Jesus says this, before you launch some kind of endeavor like a battle, it's always good to count the costs. You know, what's going on out there? If you start a business, if you're ever going to start a business in your life, you always want to say, what's going against me? How will this business not work? How will this be very difficult because of all the elements that are against me? Whatever, if it's farming, you're thinking about how often do I get a hailstorm in my land? You count the costs. And I think ministry is the same way. We count the costs. We prepare our hearts and our minds for what we're facing ahead of us before we go uphill. And I think we should do this often. Maybe there's times when we don't do this enough, is we just say, we stand back and we say, you know, I wish I could say it's my personality that will win all of this. It's because you're looking at me and you're saying, you know, I mean, just look at him. He's it, you know, like this. But, you know, the reality is even if that was true, it was personality. It would last for what? Just a short period of time, and people change the channel, go to a better channel, a better guy. And then you eventually would reach Joel Osteen at one point and say, he's like the paragon of good looks, entertainment, all that. What am I trying to say is you count the cost in ministry. You say, Lord, before I do this, can you show me what am I dealing with here? Well, I mean, how are the odds really stacked against me? And what am I going into? I think the people of God, the church, it's a healthy thing for them to ask that question, whether they're going into Awana, children's ministry, maybe working with the hospitals in the area with regards to older people, shut-ins or something like that. What's what's really facing me? I want to know the spiritual reality of the climate of the thing that I'm stepping into. And we have indicators from that in Scripture. And I even give for you Luke chapter 16 before we go into our passage on page 104 in front of you. Christ, you know, did this many times with his disciples, and sometimes it was just with even a whole crowd of people, all these Israelites standing around Jesus, and Jesus would give a scenario about this is how hard it's going to be. You have a scenario there. It's just a story of a rich man who is clothed in purple and fine linen. He feasted sumptuously. He was receiving all the blessings of God, it would seem. And then there's a poor man next to him, Lazarus, and this could be an actual account of an actual historical event because it gives an actual name, the name of a man named Lazarus. And he's covered with sores. He's about to die. And he's just thankful to get anything from the rich man's table. Later on in the story, both the rich man and the poor man, Lazarus, die. And one finds himself in heaven, in the presence of God, next to Abraham's side. The other finds himself in Hades, being in eternal torment. And I don't think this is basically saying that all rich people go to hell and all poor people go to heaven. That's not what it's saying. It's just saying there's a time in which Israel was thinking, if I'm living in a rich country, like, by the way, all of us are living in a rich country, by the way, I must be blessed, and therefore I'm automatically going to go to heaven when I die. And, of course, Jesus was basically turning over the apple cart on this one and saying, you know, just the opposite can be true. Consider this. There's a man, Lazarus. He's apparently faithful. He'd been faithful all this time. He knows the name of Abraham quite well. And then there's the rich man on the other side of the coin, and the rich man is aghast that he's in perdition. He was never repentant. He was never confessing his sin. He was never depending on Yahweh. He was maybe just depending on his own stuff, but not on the Lord. And he finds himself in perdition, in hell. And notice what he says to Abraham. He says, I beg you, Father, send him to my father's house. Send somebody for help, for I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they also come into this place of torment. So the man who is under torment, he's in hell. He's under the judgment of God. He's saying, hey, if we send somebody out here, I can maybe save my five brothers, and they can become followers of the Lord. They can be followers of Christ. They can listen. The light will turn on if somebody rises from the dead, and I can go tell them. But Abraham said, and it's actually Abraham gives the rejoinder, but Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. He said, the man who is in perdition says, no, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. What's the rejoinder? Verse 31, he said to them, even if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead. And that is the kicker. That's the ultimate kicker. It's basically saying, this is how bad it could get. You've heard of people in apologetics, when you give a defense for the gospel, they say, if you could just show me a miracle, sir or ma'am, as you defend the gospel, if you could just show me some miracle, then I will believe. But you can't show me a miracle, therefore your profession of faith is false. And the Bible has a way of weighing in on that, saying, no, it doesn't work that way. Even if someone were to rise from the dead, a person would still say, no, not interested in this Christianity business, not interested in it at all. And that shows you the how dark the heart can become, how callous and immovable the darkness of the heart can be. Even if you were to give a panoramic view, okay, this is what's going to happen. This is what's going to happen if you continue to disobey God. I'm going to give it to you in living color in front of you. Prophet Ezekiel, he's doing all of that. He's working. He's going to work his body to the bone, teaching the people what's coming their way. No, that didn't really get me. That didn't really stir me. So no, I'm not on board. I'm not on board. Woo, that's hard. But you know what? It's good to know that when you go into ministry. That's the uphill battle that you're facing. Because now you know how to pray. Because how do you survive in ministry? You pray. You pray to God. You say, God, how long, O Lord? How long, O Lord, will it be this way? where we're outnumbered, where we're constantly going uphill, uphill. We need water from above. We need some water to come down to help us, to help our parched mouths that are getting dry from this long desert battle. How long, oh Lord? You know how to pray. You know how to be real. People these days in ministry, they say, can you be real? I want something real. Show me something real. And then you give them something real, and they say, that's outrageous. How dare you? So this is reality. The nation of Israel, for the longest time, generation upon generation upon generation, did the exact opposite of what they were supposed to be, is to be a holy nation on a hill. And they turned God's witness into something that was smeared with basically manure, their own manure of their own sin, their own rebellion. And for that, what is going to unfold here is the righteous, not unrighteous, but the righteous wrath of God in the form of four signs of judgment. If you want to open up into your outline, and I'm going with page 2 of 4, I'm going to take this time to read the 6.5 minute long text of Ezekiel chapter 4 and 5. Takes about 6.5 minutes to read. I will highlight for you to give you sort of something to munch on, chapter 5, verse 1, and I will read it now. And just, even if this doesn't make sense, just stay with me, we'll get there. It says, "And you," God says to Ezekiel, "you shall take from these hairs that are about to be smote in fire. You should take these hairs from your beard and from your head. You shall take from these a small number and bind them to the skirts of your robe." And apparently there, some hairs, and I'm talking in metaphorical terms, so you don't know what I'm talking about yet. Some hairs are going to be preserved in the tuck or the pocket of Ezekiel's robe while everything gets blasted to smithereens. That's the only upside to this entire passage, is chapter 5, verse 3, the hairs. The hairs that are in the tuck of the skirt, in the tuck of the robe. So just stay with me on that. So this is the siege of Jerusalem symbolized in Ezekiel's, not charade, but his visible display of things that were prophetic and actually were going to come to pass, were not imaginary whatsoever. So we begin with Ezekiel chapter 4, verse 1. And bear with me, this takes about 6.5 minutes to read. "The Lord says to Ezekiel, 'And you, son of man, take a brick and lay it before you and engrave on it a city, even Jerusalem, and put siege works against it and build a siege wall against it and cast up a mound against it. Set camps also against it, and plant battering rams against it all around. And you, take an iron griddle or skillet, and place it as an iron wall between you and the city, and set your face toward it, and let it be in a state of siege, and press the siege against it. This is a sign for the house of Israel. Then lie on your left side, and place the punishment of the house of Israel upon it. For the numbers of the days that you lie on it, you shall bear their punishment. For I assign to you a number of days, 390 days, equal to the number of the years of their punishment. So long shall you bear the punishment of the house of Israel," which, by the way, was more wicked, from what I understand, than the house of Judah below them. Verse 6, "And when you have completed these, you shall lie down a second time, but on your right side, and bear the punishment of the house of Judah. 40 days I assign you, a day for each year. And you shall set your face toward the siege of Jerusalem with your arm bared, and you shall prophesy against the city. And behold, look, I will place cords upon you so that you cannot turn from one side to the other till you have completed the days of your siege. And you, take wheat and barley, beans and lentil, millet and emmer, and put them into a single vessel and make your bread from them. During the numbers of that you lie on your side, 390 days, you shall eat. And your food that you eat shall be by weight, 20 shekels a day. From day to day you shall eat it. And water you shall drink by measure, the sixth part of a hin. From day to day you shall drink. And you shall eat it as a barley cake, baking it in their sight on human dung, which is really gross. And the Lord said, thus shall the people of Israel eat their bread unclean among the nations where I drive them. Then I said, ah, Lord God, behold, look, I have never defiled myself from my youth up until now. I have never eaten what died of itself or was torn by beast, nor has tainted meat come into my mouth. Then he said to me, see, I assign to you instead, that is, cow's dung instead of human dung on which you may prepare your bread. Moreover, he said to me, son of man, behold, I will break the supply of bread in Jerusalem. They shall eat bread by weight with anxiety, and they shall drink water by measure and in dismay. I will do this that they may lack bread and water, and look at one another in dismay, and rot away because of their punishment. And you, son of man, chapter 5, verse 1, take a sharp sword, use it as a barber's razor, and pass it over your head and over your beard. Then take balances for weighing and dividing divide the hair. A third part you shall burn in the fire in the midst of the city when the days of the siege are completed. And a third part you shall take and strike with the sword all around the city. And a third part you shall scatter to the wind. And I will unsheathe the sword after them. Verse 3 is perhaps the only upside to all of this. And you shall take from these a small number, bind them into the skirt of your robe. And of these you shall take some and cast them into the midst of the fire and burn them in the fire. From there a fire will come out into all the house of Israel. Thus says the Lord God, this is Jerusalem. I have set her in the center of the nations. This is important, by the way, when you read chapter 5, verse 5. This gives you the purpose clause of all of Israel's existence. Why did they exist in the location that they were with all the nations around them geographically? Verse 5, thus says the Lord God, this is Jerusalem. I have set her in the center of the nations with countries all around her, and she has rebelled against my rules by doing wickedness more than the nations and against my statutes more than the countries all around her. For they have rejected my rules and have not walked in my statutes. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, because you are more turbulent than the nations that are around all of you, and have not walked in my statutes or obeyed my rules, and have not even acted according to the rules of the nations that are all around you. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I, even I, am against you. And I will execute judgments in your midst in the sight of the nations. And because of all your abominations, I will do with you what I have never yet done, and the likes of which I will never do yet again. Therefore, fathers shall eat their sons in your midst, and sons eat their fathers. And I will execute judgments on you, and any of you who survive, I will scatter to all the winds. Therefore, as I live, declares the Lord God, surely, because you have defiled my sanctuary with all your detestable things and with all your abominations, therefore I will withdraw. My eye will not spare, and I will have no pity. A third part of you shall die of pestilence and be consumed with famine in your midst. A third part shall fall by the sword all around you, and a third part I will scatter to all the winds and will unsheathe the sword after them. Thus shall my anger spend itself, and I will vent my fury upon them and satisfy myself. And they shall know that I am the Lord, that I have spoken in my jealousy when I spend my fury upon them. Moreover, I will make you a desolation and an object of reproach among the nations all around you and in the sight of all who pass by. You shall be a reproach and a taunt, a warning and a horror to the nations all around you when I execute judgments on you in anger and fury and with furious rebukes. I am the Lord. I have spoken. When I send against you the deadly arrows of famine, arrows for destruction, which I will send to destroy you, and when I bring more and more famine upon you and break your supply of bread, I will send famine and wild beast against you, and they will rob you of your children. Pestilence and blood shall pass through you, and I will bring the sword upon you. I am the Lord. I have spoken. Whew. I mean, that should cause anybody just to stand back and say, if this Bible is true, I can walk away from that passage and say one thing is for sure. God is truly holy, and he truly, truly, truly takes sin seriously. He doesn't wink an eye at sin and say, maybe better next time. That wasn't so bad. Well, what just happened? What just happened? They took their children, lifted them up, little babies, placed them on the arms of an idol, and went the fire up into the sky. And wow, what a scene of getting ready for the next crop now that we got that one done. That's horrific. That's what God is responding to. He's not just waking up some morning and saying, I think I'm going to blow some things up today. No, he's responding to the rank, vile rebellion of the people that happened generation after generation after generation. And then finally, the time came when God dropped the gavel and dropped all his judgment upon, of all places, Jerusalem, the Holy Land. Now, this is not something that is just totally unheard of. If you go back, and we don't have time to do that now, but if you were to go back to Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 52, you could read about what exactly was going to happen to Israel if they repeatedly, ongoingly, mercilessly kept on violating God's commandment after generation after generation after generation, that this would come down the pike. That goes back to the time of Moses. That's centuries earlier to the time of here, the time of the prophets, which is after the time of King David. Well, after the time of King David. So you can understand what's going on here. This is not some freak incident. This is something that is strategic and is something that God said would come eventually when the people, his own people, his covenant people, decided to turn their face from his law and decided to go their own way. I'm going to say this again. I've said it before. This is for our benefit. This is not just for going through a little history. This is for us to internalize in our mind who God is, that he's holy, 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 and he takes sin seriously. That is not something that is harmful to us if we are just doing our best. I'll put it that way. We're not perfect. We confess sin. We do that. But we're just doing our best as far as following him and walking in his ways as best we can. But this is for our benefit so that we know who we're coming before when we ask God to help us. So when you ask God, God, would you please help me in this ministry? We're coming to a God who is mighty, powerful, who can control things, who can make wrath rain down from heaven. That's the God that we come before in prayer when we're praying over ministry. And that is not something that would that is not something that undoes everything, turns over the apple cart, and makes it so that you can't minister. This is something that actually enables you to minister to the one another's with compassion and all grace. I need to mention something before we go into all of this as well, too. There is an erroneous teaching that is done by Andy Stanley, who is the son of Charles Stanley, and several others who basically want to take the Old Testament and say, oh, you don't want to do that. This God of the Old Testament, he is so short-tempered, and you don't want to go with him. You don't want to even go with the Ten Commandments. Andy Stanley actually throws out the Ten Commandments, which is in Exodus 20, throws that out too. You want to go with the God of the New Testament, who is more loving, can work with us more, is more of our age, who's more modern, who is less wrathful, all this stuff about wrath. We've got to throw that out. We've got to come in with love, love, love. At the top of the pyramid is love. I want to disrupt that a little bit and say the top of the pyramid is not love. The top of the pyramid is the sovereignty of God, and God will display his love according to his will. I need to say that because there's a proof of that in Scripture. I want you to answer this question. Has God given a special gospel to fallen angels? So off the beaten path a little bit, but it helps you think. Has God given a special gospel to fallen angels? Will Satan be saved? Well, is Satan a created being? Satan created being? Yes. Did he fall? Yes. Is there a special gospel for fallen angels? No, there's not. Which means that God does not have to do what he did for us. He did it by his sovereignty. He gave us his son through his sovereign love. His sovereign love top down from the top. Because he decreed it. He willed it top down. It's not that he was indebted to us. He was not indebted to us to give us his son. He chose to by his sovereign grace. His sovereign grace. Because if you're struggling with this passage, sometimes people struggle because at the back of their minds, they think at the top of the pyramid is not the fact that God is sovereign, that he is God. The top of the pyramid is that he is love and he is bound. He must love every single thing that he has created. Well, I'm sorry. There is no gospel message for Satan and his minions. And you can read that in the book of Revelation. There's no gospel for them. So God is a God who is a covenant-keeping God, and he keeps his covenant, and he shows his love through covenants. Even our earth, by the way, our earth is under a covenant, a good covenant called the Noahic covenant, where God put a rainbow over the earth and said, I will never destroy the earth like this again. I will preserve it. That is because of the covenant love of God for preserving this earth so that you can have another generation and another generation after that. So there are aspects of God, but they are covenant-bound aspects, and they all tie in to the top of the mound. The top of the pyramid is the sovereignty of God. And so when we talk about his love and even his judgment, it is by his sovereignty, it is by his high decree, it is by his essence of being who he is. He is God. So that may help a little bit as we get into the depths of all this. And this is heavy. I know this is heavy. I would be lying to you if I said this is a cakewalk and you're just going to get through this and you're going to go home and you're going to say, oh, that was so easy. No, I will kind of get you to the point where you go, wow, I'm at a crossroad. Either this is true or this is false. I want to know because my faith is hanging on the edge right now. I have no problem talking in those terms. We go through the signs and just understand what is going on here. And the signs are pretty much clear there in the bold type on page 1, or page 2, 3, and 4. The first one is Ezekiel chapter 4, the first couple of 3 verses, and that is talking about the black iron face of God. The nations around Israel, nations around Jerusalem, they knew that they were living in times where there were warring empires. So Israel itself, Judah itself, Jerusalem knew about this thing called the siege, where you had the army. It's a great way to win a battle, is just to cut off all their supplies, come around them, and just make them so that they're almost skin and bones on the inside, so they have to throw up the white flag, surrender, and less casualties of your own men. It's a very well-known tactic. It's called the siege. And Israel was familiar with that, of course, living in the time that they did with other warring nations. I don't think that the people for that time ever imagined that their own priest of their own temple would be doing a kind of a charade or a picture analogy where he puts down a brick. You say, see this brick? I'm going to put it down, and I'm going to put these little toy siege works all around it. I'm just going to lay down and prophesy against it. And then they look at the brick and say, what's on that brick? Hey, that's the name of Jerusalem. That's our capital city. What are you're of the temple. What are you doing? This is just so bizarre. I can't take this in. That's exactly what's going on. So the people back then, probably when they saw that name Jerusalem on the brick, they automatically understood, they connected the dots, and they started to say, he's speaking about us. He's not talking about some other foreign nation that we're going to take over. He's talking about our own capital city. So they had a work through this. This was a kind of a grueling thing to see, and it intensifies as you go from one sign yet to another. There's this weird thing that you know, some people might not even not accurately know what it is, but there's a time when Ezekiel is laying down beside this mock city, this mock siege. And he takes a black skillet, you know, like one of those iron skillets you make eggs with or bacon or whatever. and he sticks the handle into the ground or something. He fastens it into the ground, and he just faces it, blocking himself off from the city. That shows you just a kind of an iron, black iron madness of God Almighty saying, you know, like I used to say, it used to be in the days of Israel, you've heard this in the benediction number 6, the Lord bless you and keep you, the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you, the Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace, make his face shine on you. Now what's happening is there's this big iron skillet facing the land, and it could be that Ezekiel is actually pushing it towards the city. And that would be an easy picture of just God's basically saying, when I leave the temple, you're going to know a side of me that you're not that acquainted with towards you. And that is going to be my face turned away. And therefore, what's left is a black iron thing facing you and pushing against you. This is the judgment of God display. This is, I could just say this outright, this is a hellish display of judgment. Hellish, like Gehenna, that sort of thing. Torturous. Sign 2, national paralysis. You know what it is to be paralyzed? Maybe you've gotten in a ski accident and you've broken your legs or you've broken your ankle and you just have to lie there, and each time you get up, boy, does it the pain just shoots right through your leg. Nobody likes to be like that. Nobody likes to be stuck in one area with all that inertia, like with their legs and stocks. But Ezekiel is giving a display of this. The nation is like tied down. It's like having ropes tied around you. And you're like tied to the ground and you can't get up. You can't move to the left. You can't move to the right. You're stuck. This is very much the picture of in the medieval era, they had these things called stocks. Stocks were like two pieces of wood with holes in them. And they would put your arms in them. And then they would put your feet in them. And you just stayed there. And it was a form of torture. You know, what are you going to do? You're at the mercy of everyone. The cross behind me, by the way, is somewhat of a picture of that, being nailed. Can't move. Can't get my arm off here. Can't get my arm off there. I'm stuck. That is one of the most grueling forms of judgment. And the people here were stuck. They were stuck within their own walls as a siege encamped around them and basically cut off all their supplies, the water, that train of food that would always come in every so often, cut off, so they didn't have food. And they start to connect the dots that God is the one who's making the siege. The prophet, former priest, Ezekiel, as he lays there, he does something that's very odd. Most of us, when we talk to someone, we talk to a living, breathing person. We don't talk to an object. But what Ezekiel does here, he talks to that brick, and he goes, I told you this was going to happen. I told you this was going to happen. And now it's happening. He prophesies against the brick. Well, what's on the brick? Jerusalem. Jerusalem is on the brick. And the people start saying this. Wait a second. We have a prophet who's prophesying against Jerusalem. That's us. This whole display of these little toy soldiers in the siege, that's God delivering judgment on our capital city. And it would be something horrific to see. Perhaps the people knew parts of this. Maybe they didn't internalize all of it all at once. But it was becoming more clear as the drapes were pulled back and those four signs became more lucid and more clear in the mind of the one who's watching all this, hearing all of this as well. The four signs have an aspect that doesn't just have to do with the audible noise of Ezekiel prophesying against the brick. Doesn't have to just do with the sight of Ezekiel being tied down or the brick being tied down and having all these toy soldiers around it. But on top of that, there is the smell of war as well. And there's a scene which is just most odd in part 3, and it has to do with how you cook food. God says to Ezekiel at first, he says, this is what I want you to do. Probably use the same skillet that you had there before. It's time for you to eat. You're going to camp here for 390 days. That was probably the amount of time that Israel was going to be under judgment. And of course, Judah for 40 years as well after that. But just stay where you are in front of this model city or the siege works, this little encampment that you constructed with the brick in the middle. And now it's time to eat. Well, what are you going to eat? Well, relieve yourself, and that dung can be used as fuel for the skillet that has just a couple of grains. You just get one meal a day, couple of grains. And now you got not just the audio and the visual, now you have on top of that the smell. The smell. Some people I know who've worked in hospitals and places that are below standard can tell about the smell of feces, the smell of urine, and you go, whew, man, that's not edifying to come to that every single day. Well, here you have the smell of dung emanating. Of course, God revises it because Ezekiel says, well, I'm just going to defile myself if I do. You're supposed to leave your refuse. You're supposed to leave that outside the camp. You're not supposed to even let it exist in front of you. And so God makes it so that a cow's dung can be used instead. There's a little bit of an exception there. But this was all a foreshadowing of the desperate times of just getting food to your mouth. How do we get food to our mouth? How do we cook our meals? Well, everything's in the storehouse. We have a storehouse over there. We have a storehouse over there. They're getting pretty empty. There's no more wood. Our supplies are running out. We can't have meat. We're just eating a little bit of grain every couple days. And now comes the time in which the light starts turning on. And people start saying, I think he's talking about us. And I think he's saying that we're going to be on low supply of supplies. That's exactly what happens when a siege is occurring. You have a little blurb at the bottom of page 3 or 4. How could God do this? Of course, this is not God waking up some morning and saying, I think I'm going to judge this people willy-nilly just because I feel like it. This happened on the tail end of their repeat abject sin. They were basically sinning worse than the pagan nations around them. And by the way, this is something for us as well, too. Remember the Apostle Paul in the book of 1 Corinthians. Didn't he say something about the church was laughing at a particular sin that even the pagans know that's out of line? That's not laughable. That's not funny. A man sleeping with his own relative or something like that. That's outside of the limits. Even within the pagan world, that's not allowed. And the church of Corinth was, of course, laughing along with that. Whisper, whisper, hee, hee, ha, ha. No, no. This is exactly what was going on with regards to Israel. They had a moment, a sin moment, where they were sinning worse than the neighbors around them, to the point that the pagan neighbors were going like, well, at least we're not as bad as, you know, the Israelites, because they're pretty bad. I mean, you've seen what they've done, and it's ruthless, it's pretty heinous, it's sick. But we're Hittites, we're Amalekites, and we're a cut above that. See, it was just inverting, and this is how bad it was getting. Page 404 on the Mac, the systematic slaughter of all of them. This is probably the hardest thing to read. We already read it. I had one who wasn't the best teacher I had. He was a little bit of a liberal, but he, in one giving of just the explanation of God's judgment, he used the analogy, he liked to use the analogy of movies a lot, but he gave the analogy of The Terminator, which is, I think, a highly violent movie that you don't want to see. But the Terminator is this iron-clad guy. He's basically an iron robot. And he just chases after his target relentlessly. And I think the analogy, as I first heard it in my 20s, was this is how much Satan wants to go after you when you sin or you're tempted to sin. He's like a Terminator, and he's just going to run after you. And, you know, and you're going to be going, ah, like this. And, you know, you got to outrun him. And, you know, the theology was not the best in the world at that time. But you get the idea. Just like a human tank that will not give up. And he's going to use everything in his power to go after you. Hard to say this. God was exactly that way with his people, with Jerusalem. He was like the Terminator. The Terminator doesn't give up. He doesn't say, well, I got 33% done with, they're judged, I'm done. No, he goes for the next 33% that got away, that got out of the city. So he goes after them. Then there's another 33% after that, another third. He goes after them with a sword. That just shows you the relentlessness of God. He's saying basically, when I judge, I'm going to be so thorough, it will make your jaw drop, and you will say, that must be of God. He ran us out the gate, and then he ran us into the next city, and then he got us with a sword at the very end of the corner of the street. Except for chapter 5, verse 3. There's a few hairs that were not singed. They were not thrown into the fire. They were not cut with a sword. There's a few hairs that Ezekiel took up, and he probably lifted them up like this and said, I'm going to keep these close to me. I'm going to keep them where they're not singed and they won't be harmed. Just a few hairs, just a few, I'm going to put in my pocket. These ones are safe. And that's the story of Israel. A few hairs survived while all perished by the sword and by fire. And that is what we call the remnant few. Those who stay faithful, those who keep their hands to their plow and still have to do what everybody else does. They have to confess sin. They have to say, Lord, I didn't do such a good job that time. Please forgive me. But they keep their hands to the plow and they stay faithful. And God preserves their lives. Wow. What an amazing picture. This picture is not exclusive to the Old Testament. It is, in fact, repeated in the book of Revelation. When you start to read the book of Revelation, you start to see again, like the curtains are opening up once again. And now God is judging in a horrific way across the whole side of the globe, across all lands, for all times. Except for the church, except for the people of God that are in his hand, and they're close to the prophet, they're close to the revelation of who God is, and they're kept. They are preserved. All else thrown into the fire. This is a sobering picture. It is not for the purpose of theatrics. It is not for the purpose of us just having a wow moment. It is for the purpose of helping us persevere as Christians and actually carry out the Great Commission. When we treat things as they truly are, how are we dealing with people who are hard to the revelation of God? We first have to be sober in our own hearts before we go jumping into the ring and giving people the gospel. We have to be sober in our own hearts to realize that the things are actually stacked against us with regards to the hardness of man's heart. But through prayer and appealing to the God of heaven, appealing to the Almighty, we might understand a greater way to do ministry with God's help from above, even in face of everything being against us, statistically speaking. With that, I'm going to close because I went 5 minutes over time once again. And if you have any questions, do see me afterwards, and I'll be staying around after the service as well.